How are you?
Good.
I got older, huh? Yeah. So how many of you have come to a Friedman seminar in your life? Wow, so few. So many leads. Well, I'm happy to be here. Are you happy to be here?
I'm ecstatic.
You look ecstatic. I mean, it's another day of knowing that you own a retail store, right? And then you're still alive. We have a fun show for you. What do you think? Yeah. May drive you crazy with a couple of little things. We'll change your business if you're paying attention. If not, I'm just so darn smiley that you're just going to enjoy it anyway. So before we get started, I want to tell you something very interesting that happened to me. And it has nothing to do, we were going to put some PowerPoints on it, but you could look it up. You could look it up later. And if there's no real good reason for what I'm about to tell you, I just want to tell somebody. You're the closest to me now. So about 5 months ago, I bought a bar. Oh my God. First of all, I have never been a waiter, a bartender, a cook, but it seemed cheap. You know, like some of the jewelry you buy. It seemed like kind of a deal, and it was two miles from my house. And I, even though I've never been a bartender or a waiter or a cook, I had a tremendous affinity for the product. You know, like you guys do, you know. I have a certain feeling about. But interesting, the place turned out to be a beer bar, which I think the joke is on me because I don't like beer. So that's cool. I'm not going to be drinking the inventory. Thought it was going to be a wine place because I'm a little bit of a wino. So I buy this place and I just said to myself, well, what do I know about any of this garbage? I have no clue. And I figured, well, I do know how to run a business. I mean, at least that's what they pay me for. And shmigiggies like you come and listen to me tell you how to run your business. Somebody, this has got to work. So I took what I knew, which was process, which we're going to talk a lot about, benchmarking, which we're going to talk about, and some of the kind of uglier parts to making your business go right. How's that? We're not going to talk about opening the sale today or how to handle Mrs. Schmidtlap who says, I'll be back. We're not going to talk about that. We've got plenty of resources for that. I think some of the other yokels were talking about that anyway, so let them talk about it. I got tapes on it. This is buy my shit. It's much better. This is without a doubt. You want me to start from the beginning?
No, that's okay.
All right. Sure. See, can't even take responsibility for your own lateness. Have to blame the bus driver. Now, of course, that works with employees too, doesn't it? So you gotta, there's a thing in LA, I don't know if it's a national thing, called Yelp. Is Yelp all over the place?
Yeah.
So I'm gonna give you the name of the bar. You gotta look this up. You gotta see what I got going. I am within 4 months, first of all, I'm 5-star rated, which is not easy to get, right? So they're not all 5-stars, but I'm a 5-star rated gastropub. Well, I named it that. I eat the food, the tremendous amount of gas that I can generate from any of my food. I think they call it a new American pub or something. And so we're 5-star rated. You got to read the reviews. You won't believe it. And this is from a guy who doesn't know anything about building a bar. So if you don't think I got it, baby, read that stuff. And there may be a few comments about me being in there a couple evenings inebriated. Don't worry about that. I've caught you in your store wearing jewelry. It's the same thing. I don't see any big difference. It's called Crazy Harry's Bar. Crazy Harry's Bar. And we've got to write down the town because no one has ever heard of it. Although they have it in Illinois. Winnetka. Wow. Is anybody here from L.A.? You are? Where?
Oh, we're from Orange County.
Yeah, well, Orange County is like not from... Yeah, Orange County is like another country. What's that? Yeah, W-I-N-E-T-K-A. W-I-N-N-E-T-K-A. Winnetka, California. Crazy Harry's Bar. Look it up. I think it's interesting as hell. It's much more fun than talking about jewelry. Now, the show is required that I have, they gave this to me to use. I think you'll find it fun that every time I didn't know where to put another slide, I inserted that in again, just to remind you who I was. It's very funny. Hopefully you'll get the whole thing. So Marlene Cordry, who is the president of the Friedman Group, I've demoted myself, and for good reason, and she is spectacular and only been with the company 15, 16, how many years?
Closer to 18.
18 years. Now, just the thought of me having any employee for that many years, you have to give me props. And then we have Karen Berry, the delightful Karen Berry, who's going to be doing a couple sessions today, right?
Yes.
You've been around a shorter period of time.
6 years.
6 years. She's great, so don't miss her pontificating. Unfortunately, my clicker clicked out, so Marlene is clicking for me. Oh, listen, you gotta be able to bob and weave. Don't be so inflexible. Here we go. Let's hit these things. And we're going to drive you a little bit crazy because we're using Prezi instead of PowerPoint. It's a little bit different. So here it is, the greatest jewelry store owner's question of all time. The greatest question of all time, which is... How do I double my sales? What do you think? Now, it's a ridiculous assumption that you, particularly you, and I mean you, could double your sales. Because if you could, you would have, and you didn't, and that's that. So we're going to talk about the processes and the actual analytical part if you were to actually want to double your sales. Well, I'll show you how to get there. Now, there is a caveat. And it's a big one. If you sell garbage, fair enough? Tough to do, right? If no one can ever find your store, probably going to be tough to do. But let's just say for a moment that you have a reasonable store. How's that? You know, maybe not the best, but it's not the worst. You have a nice store. You know, the merch is good. Merch is good. Yeah, you've made a couple of mistakes, you know, three-headed dolls, a couple things, you know. Just selling as keepsakes or whatever. Maybe a too big of a grandfather clock collection. You know, there are things that you could have that might not be selling a lot. But if all things are created equal and you're getting some folks to come in and visit you every once in a while, right? Then we could do some amazing things. And you're going to get exhausted the next few minutes, but let's just go ahead and tell you what's really happening. So the process of wanting to double sales, no matter what, is going to be benchmarking, process, and culture. Those three things. And you got to know about those three things. And you're going to get exhausted knowing about these three things. Because, in fact, small independent retailers who wear more hats than anybody else on the planet, who are more things to more people every single day, and, right? And it's exhausting just even, you know, you're putting the key in, you're going, I'm exhausted. You just woke up, you know, because you haven't recovered for the last 6 months. And we've had our booty handed to us the last couple of years, don't you think? I mean, it's been just fabulous, our economy and all the things that are going on, and God only knows we need jewelry. And we'll talk a little bit about that. Yeah, we'll talk a little bit about the idea that you're not even selling the right stuff. I mean, you're not selling jewelry. For God's sakes, the more you talk about jewelry, the more you're just boring the hell out of me. It's just ridiculous. You sell sex, and that's all there is to it. You are sex providers. Just own it. Live up to it. Acknowledge it. Look, when jewelry is purchased, sex happens. Look, you just get, I just never understood why never, and look, women who have lots of jewelry do not give a lot of sex. Sure, think about it. She's got a lot of jewelry because every time he says, I got to have a little more jewelry. If they don't have a lot of jewelry, it's like the 60s. I'm just saying, think of it, you're going to get this somewhere around 3 o'clock this morning and it's going to come to you. So there is all sorts of historical reasons why jewelry is important. How long are you going to be aggravating me, really? All throughout the whole thing? Really? Oof. Well, at least get me with some pretty girls. Oh, my God, my life. I'm single again. Can you imagine? Again. Oh, this is like opening and closing stores. I'll tell you that. It's just so I have no, and don't come to me with anything. I have no available cash. State of California, the whole thing. Anyway, look, you don't sell jewelry. Stop selling jewelry. It's got nothing to do with anything, really. It's tchotchkes that women want, right? Guys don't want it. Women want it. Let's just leave it at that. You sell a cufflink every once in a while, and then all of a sudden you have 35 cufflinks, and you sell the one. Skip cufflinks. There's got to be a www.igotcufflinks.com. Don't compete with them. They've got the cufflinks. Anyway, it's spiritual. You don't take it completely seriously. We sell engagement rings, right? The jewelry business is engagement rings and some watches. And what? Yeah, it's not even jewelry, it's Pandora. Do you love that? Oh, my God. And they're their own people. I went to Denmark to meet with Pandora, and it was an amazing meeting. I didn't get the job. My Danish is weak. But what a home run that's been, right? Just terrific. And we'll talk a little bit about that, but not Pandora specifically, but... It comes in as a very, very important part of your analysis of your business and where you're taking it and so forth. But what we're looking for, no matter what, is we Marlene, what did it say before that? You got me all mushed. Really? Yes. Benchmarking progress and culture. It's a matter of that for the purpose of maximum repeatable extraction. Now, you know what that means, don't you? Of course. What is the goal of a salesperson? The goal is to extract the most amount of money possible out of anybody's bank account. Does anybody have a problem with that? If you could spend $5,000 on a ring, you could spend $10,000 on a ring. Would you agree with that? And you could spend $15,000 or $20,000. What do you want? You want the 20 or you want the 5? No, what do you want, really? What do you want? You want the 20 or you want the 5? Well, you want the 20, and I'll tell you why. They're going to go back to work and make the money back. And 4 years later, they will have completely forgotten how much money they spent on the ring. And she's showing her friend her diamond ring with a loop. No, it's there. It's next to my other finger. It's the silver thing. These little chips. She's got to wear that for the rest of her life. I've always wanted to like do a diamond engagement ring intervention service. You know what I mean? Right? It's like, no, come on. Dude, you get her a bigger ring than that. Screw quality. Go big. Always. Jewelry people are so sensitive about the quality of the stone, it's because you've learned to be sensitive about the quality of the stone. And you come to store shows like this where, you know, Mochem is talking to this guy and he's saying, hey, this is the greatest quality in the history of the rock. And you can't see it, but it just, you can't see it, but it's good. Women want, look at that! And then she wants to see it, go, I gotta go. Big is better. The four C's, it's the five C's. It's always been the five C's. I've been teaching this for years. The four C's, are you kidding me? What? It's the five C's, and the fifth C is more important than all four put together times 1,000. And it stands for the number of compliments she gets because she's wearing it. And everything else is garbage. God, let's get a life here. Who gives a shit? It's a stone. It's metal. And you're going, woo, this guy can't even, you forgot your socks. Kidding me. Unbelievable. So I want the most amount of money out of every single customer, no matter what. What do you think? It's a way of life. I don't want to leave money on the table because I didn't have the skills, ability, and knowledge to get it. Fair enough? And people want it anyway, right? And they walked into your store free and clear, right? Nobody pushed them in. A couple husbands have been dragged in. It's a different story. It's the way it is. It's a woman's world. All right. Well, it all starts with a love story. And here you thought I was just going to be this irascible old guy. But it's really about love. It is about love. I'm in love. Marlene, show them what I'm in love with. I'm in love with these numbers. God, I love these numbers. You must know these numbers. You have to know these numbers inside and out. You have no choice. If you're going to build your business, you need to know these numbers. Now, we're going to visit them in a moment, so I'll get that back up there. But, oh, my goodness, I love you to death, and if you don't know these numbers, I'm going to smack you. Okay? Got it? This is it. I don't care what motivational garbage you're going to listen to from now till the 2 weeks from now. This is it. We hang out here. We live here. We stay here. And we run our business here. It's what it's all about. Okay? So we'll get back to that in a moment. Got a little music on that one. Just doing a little. Okay, get rid of that, guys. Now, consider baseball. Why? We're in Chicago. They have the Cubs. Should never consider baseball in Chicago with the Cubs. But if you were for just a moment to consider baseball, and I picked baseball because even if you hate baseball, you know a little bit about baseball, right? I mean, somewhere along the line, you know a little bit about baseball. And I'm going to tell you, I think differently than most people. Of course I do. There's only two statistics in baseball that make baseball baseball. Look what they are. Batting average and errors. You would have never written that down. If I said, what are the two important numbers, you wouldn't have written that down, would you? No, you wouldn't. You wouldn't have read those two. And I want to tell you why I'm exactly right. Because I'm tight. No matter what's going on, if the guy's batting a heavy batting average, we like him. What do you think? Flat out, like him. The guy's batting 380. He's not only a multi-gazillionaire, we really like him. Unless he keeps dropping the ball. So if he hits it all the time, but he doesn't drop the ball, oh my God, this guy's a hero. Yes or no? Think about it. There's only two parts to baseball. You get up, you hit it, ball comes to you, you catch it. Thank you. Anything else you want to talk about? What?
Win.
What?
Win.
No. That's absolutely incorrect. And I love the fact that you brought it up. He talked about winning. You see, winning is the result of the collective efforts of individuals. It is not a team sport. It is a team result. And this is why we make business fundamental errors every single day by thinking like a team, saying we're a team and all that stuff. That's not what it is. Dead wrong. It's an individual sport as a collective team. Do you see what I'm saying? So what happens is you would have to say, there could be one other stat here. You've opened my mind. Did the guy throw the ball reasonably well to the other guy? But it still results in an error if he didn't sell it, right? So it's errors, period, right? So it's batting average and errors. Capiche? That's it. If everybody had a great batting average and they didn't drop the ball, you'd probably have a lot of...
wins.
Oh, there you go. So what we have to learn this morning, and we will throughout the thing, is I'm not about results. I'm about the things that cause results. Okay, so we'll talk about that. Benchmarks for these statistics are what separate minor league players from major league players. Did you know that? Because if a minor league player starts having a real high batting average and keeps catching balls, he becomes a major league player. Just that simple, right? I just wanted to show you that picture again. I told you we'd be seeing it often. Oh, look at what we have here. But alas, benchmarks in the world of jewelry retailing are what separate top performers from poor performers, period. End of story. And by the way, on that slide that we had back a while ago on the baseball error thing, it said it wasn't about how well they got along in the clubhouse. Something like that, right? Because, frankly, a lot of us get concerned about the mood, the beat, and the tempo in the clubhouse. We want to be a family. We want to be a team. We want to work together. Crap. I would rather be really rich and have a couple pissed off people than broke and have Shabbat dinner together. Whatever that is. All right, let's go back to these things. I'm going to leave this up sufficiently for you to copy it. Or, I don't know, we can get it to you somehow. Whoa, where are you going with that? Don't start randomly hitting buttons. Because I'm not so sure all these guys know what these numbers are. Now, conversion rate are the number of Muslims that go Christian. It's a low number. It's a bad stat. We're not making progress. But if we were to talk about jewelry instead, we would really be talking about the number of bodies that walk into your store that you say hello to. And frankly, which ones count? That's right. So we have a simple belief system is that if a person crosses your lease line while having a heartbeat, special dispensation to those that are dead before they came in. Right? You know, it's like, who's behind you? Oh, Lou, he died yesterday, but I still haven't found that ring. You know, that's a whole nother thing. Thank you for having a sense of humor. Do you track conversion rate in your store? No. Okay. So, Alan, do you have a store? Okay. And so you don't track conversion rate, and this is really kind of an interesting thing, and I'm not picking on you in particular. Probably am. I mean, the video, when we see it later, it'll look like I picked on you. Conversion rate is the second holiest number in all of retail by far. And all it's telling you is you talk 10 people came in and you sold two of them, or you sold three of them, you sold one of them, right? So let's take a look at that. At the lower levels of conversion rate, and let me just go real fast, conversion rate is often dictated by your store location, right, and your traffic. And as we know, the further away your store is from mankind, okay, the more people are on a mission to go there, okay? The conversion rate is higher. The more you're smack dab in the middle of a shopping center where people come in all the time, easy to get to, right? They're falling into your store, conversion rate is less, okay? These we know. There are industry numbers that we know through years and years and years of experience but they're not your numbers, and who really cares? What's yours is yours. How's that, right? I mean, wherever you're starting is where you're starting. All we want to do is figure out whether we can move it. But the impact of moving conversion rates is ridiculous. If you're selling 2 out of 10 and you go to 3 out of 10, what kind of a sales increase did you just have? Yeah, 50%. Anybody interested? You know, and if you were at 3 and you went to 4, you still have a third. 4 to 5 is 25. 5 to 6 is still a 20% increase in sales. Are you kidding me? I mean, this is like the wildest stuff you've ever seen in your life. And if you really want to get a handle on how this looks, let's use this row. You're my row.
Nice.
Stand up row.
Hey, we're winning row.
You're the, you're Lou, you're everything. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Would you please stand up? So look at these gorgeous people. They walked into my jewelry store, okay? And I do a little, you know, hey, how you doing? Can I help you thing on them?
Just, of course.
And I sell these guys, right? And they sit down because I sold them, right? And maybe I sold them 5,000 each, right? Okay, there's no speaking part for you. Really. Chill it out. Now, what happened was is that I sold 2 out of 10, and if I caught them for a reasonable average sale, you know, something that makes you happy, 1,500, 2,300, 3,000, whatever the heck it is, life almost seems to get celebrated on that moment, right, you see. But the thing that I'm the most, what the hell happened to these guys? What happened to them? Why did they leave? Why weren't they sold? Why didn't somebody else have a chance to sell them? What were they looking for that was so special that we didn't have, we can't get, we can't draw a picture of? Okay, you guys sit down now. Thank you so much. My life is about these. You're a loser. If you sell less than 50% of the people you talk to, you lose more than you win. So we worry a lot about sales training when sometimes we should be talking about how do we prevent losing so many damn sales? You spend more time losing sales than you do making sales, yes? And yet we spend time doing sales training. Well, sales training are how to make a sale. But when you don't look at the yin to that yang, right, and try to figure out what the hell did I, was it when I get nervous I pick my nose? Is that the point where I lose it? Or, you know, one of these? Where am I losing the deal, right? And as we learn about the fundamental structure of salesmanship, and in fact, it does have sections. This is so annoying, really. Yeah, you're going to have to take your best shot. Let's get a pretty girl, though. Come on, right here, front row. No, you stand over there.
Who, me?
No, the photographer. Move your leg here. I got all these beautiful. Can I just get one here? Okay. Oh, geez. That's enough for all of us. Okay.
Thanks.
I'm like not that important. You know? Maybe they said, take a lot of pictures of them, makes them feel good. You know? So conversion rate has this amazing, amazing, amazing fallout to it. First of all, it's a confrontation that a salesperson's responsible for who they say hello to. You're telling me you don't have conversion rate in your store. You're telling me you don't want your salespeople responsible for the customers that they walk up to. Now, this is a game of high accountability, or it's a game of no accountability and don't bother. But if you think that there might be some difference in conversion rates between salespeople, well, there is, and it could be significant. Given that average sale can be similar, all right, let's make a leap of faith here for a moment. Let's say an average sale is $750, and you got one guy converting at 40%, you got one guy converting at 20%, one guy's making you lots of money, and the other guy's killing you. Yes? But you know what? They do special orders so good, I like to keep them. And they're adorable. Kind of got the sweets for her. What the hell? It's about business. Yes? Did you open a retail store because you're so pathetic you needed friends? Is that how pathetic you are? Let me introduce you. Go to church. Go to synagogue. Go somewhere, meet, donate some money, you'll have friends. But not at the store. So conversion rate's everything. Now, let's go to the second one, average sale. You know all about average sale. Average sale is the function of two things. They are selling better stuff, right? So instead of selling that $500 chip, you sell a rock. And then you learn to sell. You go from rocks, you go to doorknobs. Because women deserve doorknobs on their finger. Right? That's it. Oh, I can't lift my hand. It's also part of the divorce settlement. It's like paid for already. It's all part of the thing. You own half that thing, you see, in the court. But I'm just having a moment. Okay, I'll get back. All right. Average sale is made up of the ability to sell better goods, yes? But it's also the ability to sell additional items. Correct. So it's two-fisted selling. You got this? You gotta have that. Right? Whatever the hell that is. Now, the jewelry business is not particularly good at adding on. We're not. Clothing business is great at it. Average number of items in a good clothing sale might be 3 items in a clothing sale. We're happy to get 1.2, 1.3, 1.4 items per transaction. And sometimes the additional item isn't really worth it. You know, I mean, it's some, you know, jewelry cleaner doesn't count.
Hey, boss, I sold some jewelry cleaner.
God, I hate that. Put your hands up if you sell jewelry cleaner. Come on, don't lie to me. Don't lie to me. Put your hands up. Oh, about 10 bucks? Oh, how much? 15. You have some good cleaner. Louis, is it you again talking? All right. Louis, I need you to just be quiet and I'm going to help you. Louis, the shit costs 50 cents. Why you're selling it for $15 is ridiculous. You can buy that stuff by the 55-gallon barrel. Anything they have in some glass jar is not what you think it is. It's just a nice glass jar. So you get to some supplier in Hong Kong and he'll send you some blue shit that'll work. And you call it Her Majesty's Secret Crown Jewel Cleaner or something. And you sell it for $19.95 and it has a little sticker on it and says, you ready for this? Louis will never do it, he's too cheap, but listen to this. Sell it for $19.95 and just say free refills for life. Then the schmuck might come back in the store again. Yes. You'll make more money giving it away than you would ever selling it. If let them buy the first one at $15.95 and then free refills for life. Just make sure you buy it by the 55-gallon thing. You have your own little laboratory going on. I mean, just get some Windex. The shit works. I don't know. I've used toothpaste on occasion. Sparkled like hell. $15 jewelry. You guys, my God. Let's start selling jewelry. You want a rouge cloth to go along with that? I'm really racking it in now, baby. Oh, my God. All right. So we know that average sale can vary by salespeople, and if you're not tracking their individual statistics, you don't know it. You're recording? They're allowed to? You're allowed to. So. Well, then I'll talk about you so you can share it with people. In fact, this moment is talking about you on the tapes. It's amazing. And your name is?
Eric.
Eric is the one that's recording that we're talking about. Do you have a girlfriend or wife?
Girlfriend.
Yeah, her name?
Haley.
Haley, it's Eric who's recording. Now we got the whole family involved. So without high accountability in your store, you have no idea whether a guy could sell the better goods, right? Or his knees get weak as the sale gets bigger, right? Now, we've done these studies 100 times. University of Michigan, I think, did it. American Express has done it. I mean, there's all sorts of studies where we send people in with credit cards and we say, just keep buying. As long as they're selling, you keep buying, right? There's no limits. Just keep going. And the salespeople always stop before the customer does, right? I think the American Express one was five experiences. One customer bought three items. Two bought one and one bought two. That was it. And there was no limit. They could have just kept buying. Their only rule was if the salesperson didn't say, would you like it, that they were not to buy it. But the salesperson quit well in advance. Have you ever had the experience in your career where the salesperson or yourself quit in advance? Do you have a friend that may have happened to? Did you read about it in my book? Shake your head up and down. Give me some encouragement. I'm working my ass off up here. Okay? So you're whimpering sacks of jello. You know it. And that's why you're not making any money. The thing is, this is a free country. And in the United States of America, it's perfectly legal for a customer to say, enough already. And frankly, those are the words that I like to hear. Enough. Stop. I can't have any more. This is it. No, don't show me anything else. Doesn't that sound good? Huh? Doesn't that sound good? Sounds great, right? But you're afraid. You're a scaredy cat. You're meek. Come on. They can't buy it if you're not showing it. Is that true? Oh, that would be like taking a kid to Disneyland and not showing them Tomorrowland, thinking that it wouldn't be interesting. There's rocket ships in Tomorrowland. Of course it's interesting. That was a very sophisticated analogy. It's a good metaphor. Did you like it?
Yes.
Yeah, no, a lot of people don't get it. Number three is the percentage of repeat customers. You don't even know this number. You do now. Here's what you need to do starting right this second. You need to start tracking every single invoice, whether they're a new customer or repeat customer. And I'm about to tell you something. I discovered this about a year and a half ago. I'm the only one talking about it. Unbelievable. Where was I the last 30 years on this one, right? It is the only statistical proof of your customer service. Period. You can do anything you want. You can measure customer service 1,000 different ways. You could call in the Gallup poll. You can do anything you want. But the reality is, if they're not coming back, your service stinks. Do you agree? Do you agree? If they're not coming back. Now, of course, in the jewelry business, you know this. It's not going to happen overnight. Jewelry purchases are more, right? It's not like clothing. I mean, the selling cycle is a little bit longer, right? Could be 6 months, 8 months, could be a year, could be 2 years. Doesn't matter. But if you start tracking now, after a while, you're going to start to get a groove in it. And you never want that number to go down. All right? So listen to what you want. This is what you want. You want the number of repeat customers to increase, but the percentage to total sales to decrease. Yeah, I'm going to have to explain that again. I see your face. If there were 10 sales made today, two of them were repeat, right? So 20% of my customers, right, were repeat customers. I want, next month, I want three repeat customers. So I'm increasing the number of repeat customers. But because I want so many new ones, the percentage goes down. Not the number, just the percentage. Capiche? Guys, take this one home. Rock this in. You don't want to rock it in, you're not interested in doubling your sales. I have to know what my repeat customer ratio is. Extremely important. Get all over that. And the salespeople who are high performers anyway in your organization tend to have a higher percentage of repeat customers, don't you think? Mm-hmm. I think so too. Number of transactions. Okay, this is a kind of a Friedman newbie. We've been talking about this like insanely in the last year and a half or so. Here's the thing, guys. Jewelry as a fashion business, okay? Jewelry as a fashion business has what I call a rotating average sale. So that means if all of a sudden this brand gets hot and it carries this kind of a price tag, then it might have been a little higher than your normal price tag. Suddenly your average sale goes up, right? And your transactions can go up, right? All that, and that's all market share. It's good stuff. For example, let's take a look at the Croc story. Everybody know the Croc shoes, the plastic Croc shoes? Well, what a wonderful thing. We do stuff like that. You know, we create plastic shoes and the world goes nuts and we look at ourselves and go, wow, we're really weird. We are pretty weird. I'll tell you what, my brother manufactures something even weirder. You're going to want to know me after I tell you what he makes. My brother makes Snuggies. Yep. He also makes the upside down tomato plant. Apparently I'm gonna have to let him know that he's popular in Chicago. Snuggies are having a little bit of a tough time, but when things were going, he's making about $1 million a month. Something like that, maybe more. Kind of interesting stuff. Remind me to call him and borrow some money. Let's talk about these popular high transaction items, okay? What's that? Oh, I could sell you Snuggies. We could have them custom embroidered with the name of your store on it. Maybe we could have full sleeve Snuggies with a diamond on it. Now they're doing the whole pajama things, right, with the feet in them.
Forever lazy?
Yes.
That's disgusting. How do you fix those? I mean, people go out in public wearing, no, that doesn't happen.
Wow. We're talking about different things. Two things will happen in your business. You'll have a rotating average sales cycle. First of all, depending on the time of year, we know that. We appreciate that, right? Fair enough. But we also have to know that the impact of any particularly branded or popular item will also have a huge impact on the number of transactions you have. Okay? Transactions. Now, I'm going to think a little bit more globally than you. And you'll think a little bit more niche, but I want you to think a little bit more globally. There are only so many jewelry transactions that'll happen in your demographic in a year. Okay? Capiche? Now, it doesn't matter whether it's Rolex or Basha or Pandora or whoever the hell it is. It doesn't really matter. There's going to be so many jewelry transactions in your demographic. That means if you're in New York City, it's 5 blocks. If you're in Iowa, it's 90 miles. Whatever your drawing market is from. Okay? Do y'all get this, guys? Do y'all get that? And in many ways, it's a finite number. Okay? Now, there are some changes from time to time where some famous celebrity wears something and everybody wants it. But most of the time, that addition has a subtraction to it. So they're buying that, but they're not going to buy that. So the transactions pretty much don't change very radically. But here's what I need you guys to look at. It's a statistic that I need you to study, and that is transactions per month. Okay? I need you to look at that. Now, you know, transactions are once again market share, right? So if your transactions are growing, then you're capturing more of the market. Now, interestingly enough, it doesn't have much to do with money. It has to do with transactions. So I want you to think a little bit differently. Each transaction, you could increase your transactions, but it would be on a lower average sale, you see. Now, in the case of Crocs, like I was explaining, what happened to their transactions? It went through the roof, right? So all of a sudden, this guy's seeing 10,000 people he never saw in his life, right? That's a lot of transactions. Even though it drove his average sale down from $60 or $70 for a pair of shoes to $30 or $40, right? Which is a hit. The reality is they had a whole bunch of new people walking in the store. And here's the question. What did you ever do to get those customers to come back? What do you think the general answer was? Nothing. Right? Do you all see this? So we didn't do anything to get them back. So they weren't either they weren't clever enough to come up with a crick instead of the croc or something. But once you get a customer in your store, you got to figure out a way to own them. Would you agree with that? We got to own them. Yes? And this is not the session this morning on how do you own them and do all that stuff. We just don't have the time. But what I'm trying to do is give you what I'm telling you is more senior to all that. One is tracking the number of transactions you have, right? Certainly understanding your conversion rate and how it applies to average sale and those things. Very, very important things. Transactions are my new favorite thing. I absolutely am insane about the number of transactions. The next one on our hit list is ups per week, and this is very sophisticated stuff, and maybe you've all heard of, or some of you have heard of, the up system. Are you guys running it? Of course you are. My girls. Absolutely. Would you run it any other way? Nah. Even the ones that hate it know it's right. Right? Ladies and gentlemen, the up system is a formal rotation of salespeople and customers. Used car lots guys use it poorly, but they use it because it's correct. Now this is, again, I could do 3 hours on the up system. I'm not going to do that, but you need to have a formal rotation system. And how that works is you open up in the morning, you have a piece of paper, Johnny puts his name up first, Sally puts her name up second, and that's if that's all the people you have, then that's what you do. And if you have four people, they all put their name up. And if Johnny's up first, the first customer comes in, that's Johnny's customer, right? And he takes a whack, right? Tries to make it happen. If he loses, you understand that? And the customer walks out of the store, puts himself on the bottom of the up list, right? And he's back up. It is not a consecutive order. So it doesn't follow Johnny, Sally, Sammy, right? It doesn't follow a strict order. It's when you're done and the customers leave, you get to go on the back bottom of the up list. Now, why is this a genius level tactic for all retail stores? Well, number one, the idea that you hire a salesperson that you don't give a fair chance to make a living is ridiculous to me. It's ridiculous. And if you don't believe that some salespeople know how to manipulate rookies to be out of the way when the customers that they like walking in, then you're asleep at the wheel. I mean, I could take rookies in my day. I could take rookies, and I would just get into the most wonderful casual conversations with the door being right there. And if I liked what I saw, I'd say, "Excuse me." And if I didn't like what I saw, I would say, "Excuse me." I know how to cheat the system more ways than you even thought about the system. I've said things like, "Oh my God, I haven't seen that customer in, now we're out of earshot, ever." There's a lot of slimy shit going on the floor. Is that fair enough? And why not? They're just trying to make a living. Yes? Why not? They're trying to make a living, and they're working for an organization that doesn't have a clue how to manage them. So what you do is you knock the life out of them and you turn them into a family. You hold hands at the end of the day, you start singing kumbaya, you light lights up, and then you call the landlord telling him you're going to be 3 days late on a rent payment. Wow. You got to be kidding me. This stuff is easy if you just pay attention. Sorry about the swearing. Not going to happen. Made her mad right away. Are you ever coming back? Oh. Was it the word conversion? Okay. So an up system is a methodology of giving every salesperson an opportunity to have a fair share of customers. That was the promise when you hired them. Do you believe that? You didn't hire them and say, look, you're not going to get so many customers in the beginning. You're going to get some later. You don't do that. You hire them, you put them into a sequence, right? Blah, 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 blah. Now, here's what I know. It is scary as all get out to put a rookie on a 4-carat diamond. Agreed? Scary as all get out. So we suppress those guys. So we give it to our top guy. Don't let the bottom guy get there. And it's one of those, he never gets the experience because he doesn't have the experience, so he's never going to get the experience, and you keep him suppressed. So in cases like that, we utilize what's called a TO system. Turn the sale over, right, to somebody who may have a better chance. Now, I'm going to say some things to you. You tell me they're true or not true. Some people don't like you. Some people don't like women. Some people don't like men. Some people don't like fat people. Some people don't like too skinny of a person. Some people think your hairstyle's a little bizarre. Some people can't get wrapped around your accent.
Oh, absolutely.
Some people talk too much. You're bald. You have a weird mustache, right? You have social interests that are different. Agreed. And we know this absolutely to be true. Is that true? I mean, first impressions and all that garbage. I walk up to you and I go, hi, and the guy goes, ooh. Right? And you're going, and I love this, and I will always love this, the lack of sensitivity that we have, the lack of interest that we have in helping the company, the lack of everything. It's all right there. It's all right there. It's all right there. We send Fritz to go greet the customer, and the customer goes, rah! And we go get him, Fritz, you know? you get the idea? Now we beat Fritz up for, you know, it's like, Fritz, what the hell happened?
I don't know. I don't know.
Coaching goes wonky, everything goes wonky, right? And we just don't acknowledge that. So let me just share something with you. Here's how it works. There is technology available for how to open the sale very, very well. We have landing points and assessments and the 180 degree pass. If you've read my stuff, you read my stuff. I'm telling you, it's the best stuff on the planet. I've sold more sales training than anybody in the world, than any of the other guys combined. Combined. Take all the other speakers you've ever heard of on retail selling, and I've sold more of it combined. We just finished, and don't blame me. We just did e-learning for Best Buy, did sales training for 150,000 salespeople. And it was basically, how to say, can I help you faster? Hey, give the customers what they want. My theory is they're going out of business. I wanted my fee to help that go faster. Right. Yeah, I single-handedly had no illusion that I was going to save Best Buy, but we gave it a go. We created an e-learning program. It was voted, I think, Marley, it was voted the best e-learning program of all e-learning programs of all of Best Buy. I thought that's pretty interesting, which says a lot, doesn't it? Yeah, it's like, yeah, which one's uglier? So we know how to open the sale, period. Capiche? We know how to open the sale. And we deliver an opening line of some character, right? We open, and we get on the other, our customer gives us a, you know, or we do a blow-by, they go, yeah, look, yeah, I'm just going to look around a little bit, you know, so I hand them some binoculars and a monocle, you know, so, you know, look. You guys have no sense of humor, do you? Are you kidding me? You don't do things like that? You have no sense of humor. You work in a dud place. I give people loops and microphone. I'll hand them a microscope. I'll give them binoculars. Well, I'm just looking. Well, look, here. Give them a tray, you know, like a cart. Here, when you get something, you look it up and get a little. One of my most famous things is the bicycle horn. You've heard me talk about that. I love the bicycle horn in the store. Customer says, well, I'm just looking. Well, great, that's great. What are you looking for? Well, I'm just looking. Well, good, hold this. And I give him a bicycle horn. And they go, what's that? Well, basically, it's a signal to all the other salespeople to leave you alone. If you're holding a bicycle horn, the other salespeople are not going to bother you, right? But, what could happen? You never know. Something catches your eye, bingo! You need a little help? What do you think you need to do? She says, squeeze the horn. And then here it comes. I said, let's see if it works. She goes, eh. And I go, yes. And that works quite well, you see. Then you take a piece of jewelry and you put $199 marked down to $49 and write in bold letters, I'm just looking, you see. The customer says, I'm just looking. You say, well, I have one on sale. Wow, you're easy. You see, opening sale is everything. Your ability to walk up to an entirely strange person and make friends and enjoy the process and getting them to open up and have a ball with you in the store takes skill, okay? It takes skill. I have no patience for people who don't want to do that. Your job, should you take it, is to walk up to strangers and take tremendous sums of money. If they want some jewelry, they can have it. We'll even box it for them with our special box. Now, we track, I'm about to go sophisticated on you. How many salespeople should there be on your floor? Well, that's not the question. The question is, how do you determine how many salespeople you should have on your floor? Have you ever wondered that question, anybody? What's the exact right number? How does it work? Well, there is methodology to this. First of all, here's how it works. You have to start benchmarking an average amount of time to be spent with a customer, okay? Now, there's some variables here. The guy who comes in for a repair is one thing. The guy who comes in for something simple is another. Full-blown engagement ring is another, right? There are all these kinds of things, but if you take them and lump them all together, put them in the mix masher, you're going to come up with a number, right? And there's going to be pluses and minuses, but it comes up to be a number. Is that number 45 minutes? Is that number a half hour? Is that number an hour and a half? I don't know for you, but there's a number somewhere along the line, okay? Now, let's do this without really doing it. We're going to fake do it. You with me? Fake do it. Let's say you allocate an hour presentation per customer, right? Then the number of customers that you should be able to see in a day is 8. Yes? Is that correct? This is all theoretical, but pay attention. What happens when I deliver 18 customers to that guy? What happens? Two statistics suffer immediately. What are they? Okay, listen, is it too early? No, well, number of transactions is a function of conversion rate, so you're correct on half of it. Let's say conversion rate suffers, right? Yes, and what's the next thing? No, not necessarily. You're in the ballpark, you're close, you're a cousin, but you're not blood. I heard it over here. Average sale, thank you. So the two things that suffer when a salesperson has too many customers is average sale, conversion rate go down. And these are the two most important things going on in your life, and you're ruining them because salespeople have too many customers. Right? Now you say, well, wow, too many customers. Yep, too many customers. Now, I have a client of mine. I haven't done the research in a jewelry store in a long time. So, and that's a fact. And for two good reasons. I don't want to. And I don't want to. But I could, and I could do it through you, right? You could do it instead of me having to do it. I don't have to do it. You could do it. But what I want to know is, how many ups are people getting a week? I need to know that. Because here's the mathematical formula that we'll have to get you some other time. You take the average amount of money that anybody needs to earn in order to keep their job. You take the average amount of money that someone needs to be paid to keep their job. That means that if it's $50,000 a year, that means that they're not going out looking for a job tomorrow afternoon, then it's $50,000 a year. If you pay that guy $25,000 a year, he's always looking for another job. Do y'all understand that? So there is some number out there, some number, it's not the perfect number, that kind of makes people happy, right? You understand? It's not, they're not making a lot of money, right? Did you get that? But they're not looking tomorrow either, right? And it changes, the regions change. If it's New York City, it's 75 grand. If it's, Iowa, it's $12.50 an hour. Things are different, right? So you got to get what's right for you. Now, dig this. You do everything in reverse. You say, well, if I've got to make $50,000 a year, what's my commission rate? Well, let's say it's 10%. I do everything by easily dividable numbers. Okay? 10%. So if I'm going to earn $50,000, that means I got to sell $500,000 worth of stuff. Are you with me? And if I have an average sale of $500, with me? Then how many transactions do I need to make? I need to make 1,000 transactions. So if you start backing that down, you can figure out about how many transactions he needs to make in December and June and July, because they're not the same, right? Right? Every month's different. And you start taking a look at, okay, if this guy in June or May or something, this guy needs to make, he needs to see 150 people, right? I'm just making stuff up. Are you with me? Needs to see 150 people. Now, if you don't deliver them 150 people, guess what? You might have too many salespeople on the floor. Got it? That's just the way it is, baby. This is math. Now, if the guy sees 300 people, well, you're short-changed, right? Short staff. That's when you start losing money, right? I don't have any emotion in this at all. I have no emotion in this at all. If I had to have 25 people on the floor and it's 1,100 square feet, that's fine. I don't care about that stuff. I'll never forget working with Turner Watches back in the, oh my God, when was that? Was it late 80s? They had two stores at the time. Now they're the biggest on the planet. But when I was working with them, they had two stores. 52nd and Madison Avenue, the store was 1,100 square feet. And we were doing 25 million. And that was in the 80s. How you doing? It was amazing. It was amazing. It was amazing. Lots of people in the store. All right. It's all math. Now I know I got to see what my conversion rate is on average. So what you have to have is what you call an average acceptable conversion rate. So you say, well, my conversion rate, acceptable conversion rate at this moment in time is 20%. Okay, I'm making that up. So now you know if I see 100 people and my conversion rate is going to be, I'm going to make 20 sales at 500, there's 10 grand, boom. And that's how you back in staffing, right? It's not a matter of feel. There's no feel to staffing. It's a matter of making sure that a salesperson is giving adequate care and attention to each customer, right? Period. Too short a time with a customer, your average sale suffers, your conversion rate suffers, all the things that you need to have, right? Which one of your customers is important? Really? No, really. Which one of your customers is important?
The one in front of you right now.
See, you guys are wimps. The correct answer was the first time. If I ask it twice, you start changing. Like, which one of your customers is important? They go, oh, all of them. Which one of your customers burn? Well, Mary with the blue dress and the high heels. Well, if all of your customers are important, which we'd have to really believe that. But if they were, then some magic would happen. Agreed? And we'd want to know how successful each salesperson was with each customer. Now, I know one thing for sure. Not every salesperson is going to have success with every customer. Is that fair? So your job, and Marlene will tell you this, because I hired Marlene to work for a jewelry store that I ran, 1982, I believe that was. 1982. She came to work. And Well, you don't have to believe this, but we ran a jewelry store in a mall with an 85% conversion rate. We did. And that's true. 83%. When we were at always doing cutting edge stuff. When I own retail stores, I do cutting edge stuff. You're getting the stuff that's already been worked out, right? But I'm doing stuff because I can control it and it's a little bit wacky. So when we ran a rotation system, we ran an up system, but the person that was up was not really up. What they were was to greet the customer, show some affinity, and then make a decision on what salesperson on staff would be the very best match for that customer. And that's what their job was, right? And the more flexible that salespeople would get, the more opportunities that they would get, which was a skill, you see? And it was actually quite miraculous, quite miraculous. So if this kind of a person comes in and I got one of those kind of people in the store, well, why don't I get that kind of person with that kind of person so they can be that way together? Because people who are like that, whatever the hell that is, they like that. And if you're speaking Hungarian, give them a Hungarian person, which we were a little weak on, I must say. I had a lot of shit covered. We were really weak with Hungarians. We had Dora. Oh, my God. Dora was a Japanese goddess. She only wore hair halfway down her back. It's a shame it didn't grow on her head. Absolutely gorgeous. And only wore dresses that flowed. What kind of dress is it? Like silk or something. And you know, it was like... It's long, beautiful hair. I mean, she could melt... iron. I mean, she was absolutely stunning. And we had Julie. Oh. Julie wore her dresses right underneath her Adam's apple. Now, I don't know what that means. But she was a whack job, right? If it was about to be popular, she'd already discarded it. Right? She was ahead of every curve in the world. We had Barbara, who was a cheerleader. She was a little chubby and a little, you know, with big dimples. And it's like, oh, yes. And, you know, gave you a cavity just talking to her. Sweet as all get out. And we had Dottie. I'll never forget Dottie. Dottie must have been 150 then. I don't know if she's still alive. She has bright red hair, freckles everywhere, wore muumuus, you know. I mean, really, really, really. We are not on a flight to Hawaii. This, United Airlines... prior to most of your births, the flight attendants wore these muumuus, you know, with this scooped neck, and oh my God, Dottie. Her chest entered the room 6 weeks before she did. And anytime you had a guy, you know, 60 plus, Dottie, right? Well, that it was done. It was like, she'd go hi and go, I'll take it. I haven't shown you anything, doesn't matter. And it was just the most beautiful orchestration of the customer base. Whatever was walking in the door, I had on staff. I mean, we would get so specific, we would say, we need an 18-year-old Japanese guy. Now, that's illegal. It is. But we did it anyway, and it was great. Right? Because we wanted to match. We wanted to make sure that, right, that the staff, the customers were comfortable. Right? We had language, right? And we had ethnicity, and we had, you know, age. We pretty much had it all. Not easy to do today, but we did it. It was an amazing thing. Now, are any of you do TOs now? Put your hands up. All right. So you guys are doing TOs. You guys are doing TOs. All right. Are you tracking the TOs? You're not tracking them. Okay, so this is learn something here. We had what was called a TO matrix. And the matrix is, if I TO to her, what's her conversion rate on the TOs I gave to her? If she TO'd to me, what was the conversion rate of TOs given to me? Well, what's the number one thing you want to be famous for? Is taking TOs. Yes? You want to take TOs. You want to take them all day long. Because although you may get 8 customers or 6 customers in a day, you might get another 12 or 15 TOs coming your way, right? I make more money with TOs than I ever make getting fresh customers. I want to be the TO guy. But I also want a TO to people that I think can close the deal because I want half that deal. And the truth is, we have all allowed customers to walk without introducing them to somebody else when there may have been a problem. Put your hands up. Show me some guilt. Smack yourself. What are you doing? What are you doing letting a customer walk out the door without somebody else saying hello? That's ego. You're not that good. Well, already I know you're not that good. You're a selfish, self-centered twit. Allowing a customer to walk out of your fine store without somebody else saying, how you doing? Agreed? Come on. We see it all the time, every day, all the time. I want the jewelry, I just don't want to talk to you. Not you, I would talk to you. Him, I wouldn't talk to. Capiche? Is it true? Is what I'm saying true? Anybody want to argue with that? Well, here's the thing. It's exhausting because this is how you double your sales. You start celebrating the value and the worth of the customer and making sure that their experience is good, not some salesperson saying, I couldn't get to first base. I'm not interested in statements like that. They do not further my goals. Of a salesperson giving me an excuse why they couldn't close the deal. Baloney. Do you understand? Baloney. Okay, we're 45 minutes behind. Let's go through the rest of these in 3 seconds. Oh, what the hell? What are you going to do? Go out to the show and buy more shit you're not going to sell? You spend some time with me, we'll have some fun. You can always buy later. Ooh, you think they're going to run out? These guys are like Lay's potato chips. The more you buy, the more they'll make. Don't worry about it. Let's turn the screen here. This is heavy stuff. So benchmarks, those pinnacles that we're trying to reach, we have to ask ourselves, where do they come from, right? So let's get on with that real quickly. They come from, number one, tuchosity. Now, this is something that I invented many, many years ago. Some of you know it intimately. Tuchosity comes from the root word tuchus. Now, for you Gentiles, which is like 3 in the jewelry business, a tuchus is this part of the body. When you pull information from that region, it is referred to as tuchosity. When you're good at it, you can become a tuchologist. I, of course, am a DT, a doctor of tuchology. And as funny as this may sound, I've been in board meetings with Fortune 500 companies, retailers that had 6,000 stores and sitting out, and they're talking about next year's goals. And in the end, I swear to God, with all the due diligence and all the reports, I got a CEO, he goes, 6%. Because in the end, really, you can have all the data and due diligence you want. Somebody's going to pick a number, right? Somebody's going to pick a number and might as well pick the higher one. What the hell? You're not going to hit it anyway. Now, we could also talk about benchmarking owner's sales performance as some sort of a benchmark in the store. Hate it. Hate it, hate it, hate it. I'll tell you why in a minute. Industry averages, there are certain industry averages and things that I like. I like to talk, you know, if I'm talking to, I remember talking to Geller years ago and saying, well, what should we be doing in jewelry repair to grow sales? I mean, what kind of numbers can I expect? He says, well, we'd like to see, you know, at least 10%, right, of your gross volume in repair. Okay, well, that's good. I don't know if that's right or not. It doesn't matter. But the next jeweler I asked, and he says he's at 2, I know this guy's missing the boat. And if he says it's 23, he's not selling any jewelry. So do you know what I mean? It may not be the perfect benchmark, but I like hearing numbers like that, guys. So I ask a lot of questions trying to know what people have. Be careful with average sale. Average sale is a function of your merchandise mix, and our mixes are so different that it's hard to get that exactly right. historical performance are helpful. Top Gun's performance is a great starting place. You know Top Guns, right? You know, the big mouth on your floor that sells a lot. Now, in figuring out benchmarks for your organization, don't forget.
I'll be right back.
Well, I'll wait. Is it like a sit-down thing? Are you gonna... Quick. Ah! That was too much information there, Fred. Okay, so guys, we're not trying to forget environmental factors, right, no matter what. And here they are. Number one, we could have construction down the block. Somebody's building a building, you know, they tear up the streets. Those things happen, right? Tenants move in and out. Keep these things in mind. We have vendor changes. What happened? Oh, yeah, no, we've already agreed I'm going long. How far am I in?
It's time to end.
The whole thing's over.
Yeah.
Watch me go through these slides. No. You're getting the full banana. I'll send you the tapes. I'll stand here by myself and finish them. Personal changes, sales promotions, all those things can impact right what we have. Okay, move it along. The potential for improvement in your organization. I think this is the first speech I did this year. I'm kind of out of practice. Here's where your money is. Send these people home. Even you can't fix a loser. Do you understand? Here's the deal. In our management course, which some of these guys, anybody been in a Friedman management camp? Yes? A couple of you, are you still on the dots? No, lazy. You? No. You guys? Absolutely. Hot. We have a mechanism for measuring, right? Medium, strong, and very powerful performance in a series of dots, red, black, and gold. And we know that if you're a poor performer, right, and you train them, they are a trained poor performer. Do you understand that? Look, guys, don't give this business any more credit than it deserves. A big, fat smile on your face, a warm heart, and some willingness is going to sell some jewelry. You got that? It's going to sell some jewelry. Do you get that? Smile on your face, a little willingness, love in your heart, a little enthusiasm, you're going to sell some jewelry. There you got something to work with, right? If they can sell something the first week or two, right, just enthusiastic as hell, they're going to sell some jewelry. Do you get that, right? But he always misses. They're always missing. Something's always wrong. They're going to blame everything in the world but their own inability to learn what they need to learn to get there. I don't take my time with these folks. They should be good day one. Do you get it? They should be terrific day one. Not in sales so much over the top, but everything about them should be good, right? Quit trying to save the world. So we could take some average performers, we could make them better with training and accountability, we could take top guys, make them great, move along. Such trouble. So how do we help these guys? Well, we're going to. Whoa! Psychedelic 101. I'm happy to have you back. By the way, could you hear me? Because we could hear you. Not feeling well, huh? All right. So what are the three things salespeople... Thank you for laughing. What are the three things that we are very concerned about? Number one is product knowledge. Agreed. Boom. Number two, salesmanship. Yes. And number three, that can affect the performance of an individual is the culture, right? We'll talk about that in a moment. Let's move it. The factors that influence sales performance and the ability to reach the numbers are these four things, period. Individual sales goals, period. Not store goals. Individual sales goals. And I need... You gotta go back. We need benchmark sales metrics. So we're going to need to know what their average sale is, items per sale, right? And the number of transactions that they have. I can't help you when I don't have the data, right? It's not a suppressive environment. It's a helpful environment. If you're missing the boat over here, I need to help you out. Now, if you're a golfer, for example, there's three stats. Fairways in regulation, greens in regulations, and putts per round, right? When they start trying to fix their golf game, they first look at those stats. Do you understand? So stats drive the world. Codified selling behaviors. How do you want your people to sell? Where is that data? I hope it's not in your head, and I hope it's not the owner trying to teach anybody how to sell, because that doesn't work, and I'll show you why in a moment. Skills, ability, and knowledge. Let's go. Boom. So you have a culture of your floor right now, and it's a skill set culture. You may have some strong PK guys with weak selling skills. You may have some average PK guys with average selling skills. You could have weak PK, strong selling skills. I mean, we have a lot of different variants there, yes? Product knowledge. But until that moment that you know where they're at with these things, you can't help anybody. Is that a fair statement? You got to know this stuff. Okay. So what we're trying to share with you this morning, and I apologize for getting behind. I was just having such a good time. We're about process. Process is the systematic, right, taking of someone from A to B. It's a process. It's not random, okay? And you have to have things in order to have process. So let's move along and talk about some of those things. For example, in product knowledge and jewelry, we could say there's componentry. Someone should know about precious metals, diamonds, gemstones, pearls, crystals, and that we could go on for design and style, which has nothing to do with componentry, right? Do you understand? Just the idea of what the hell is a solitaire, what the hell is a Tiffany, what the hell is any of those things, right? We just kind of got to know what's going on in the world of design, which is senior to style. We have to know about inventory. Right? We got to know what we carry and what we have in order to talk about a lot of this stuff. And then we also have to know about demand, right? So the word Pandora comes out, everybody either squeaks or crushes, right? Because if you have it, you love it. If you don't, you hate your life. But that's the same as Rolex, and right? We've had these over the years. Things go up and down. And you need to know that demand coming in, right? The people who say, do you have Pandora, the sale is completely different than somebody who didn't say that, okay? Move along. There's more. We get into detail about gold, the purity of gold, and the kinds of gold. Yeah, let's not do that. You know all of that by the whole idea of 14 and 18 and alloys and allergies and all that junk. So you get that. This is all part of product knowledge. And when you're setting up your product knowledge and your salesmanship process, okay, we're going to make this simple for you. Let me give you an example. When these guys, their jewelry store, when they get a new sales guy, they got to go to the Friedman sales course. It's a 3-day course, right, in the 4th-day certification. They got to go. It's not optional. And they got to go. And they have workbooks, and they have processes, and there's quizzes. We do the quizzing for them if they do the certification at our place, which they've all done. But whether they do that, or they do it through tapes, or you do it, I don't care. Shane Decker's book, I don't care. I don't really care who you use. My ex-wife is intimately involved in caring who you use. She thought I'd vote for her. She's voting for me. But it doesn't matter. Do you understand? A well-executed program, right, is going to be better than a better program that's poorly executed, right? And there's got to be a quiz at the end. There's got to be some benchmark that says, this guy knows this stuff. Whether he chooses not to use it, that's another story. Agreed? But you have to know that they know it. We have CIA, GIA, right? We got everything you want in the world. But at least when the guy gets out of that course, and if he's a graduate gemologist, at the very least, you know he knows some stuff, right? Certainly doesn't mean he knows how to sell it. And it doesn't certainly doesn't mean he's any good at it, but at least we know that, right? So I need you to know at least that about some of your people. So you can lower the bar with your standards. We got to go now. Okay. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to be done in 1 minute. 1 minute. I'm wrapping it up. I want to just show them how pretty the slides are. Raise the bar to keep your customers happy. Lower the bar to keep your staff happy. Next slide. Go. Just go through the slides. We're just going through the slides. Isn't that pretty? I love this one. Look at that. Oh, my God. Exhausted yet? Oh, God. Oh, let's take a picture of Harry. Oh, no. Look at her. She's distressed. Look at the owner of the store. Oh, God. See? Yeah, that's meaningful. He's pissed. I don't even understand that one. She is hot. Oh, there's a picture of me. And we'll leave it at that.